JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for December the 2nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's mini market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded lower against all but two of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian session Wednesday. It lost the most ground against the euro, SEK and the Swiss franc in that order, while it was found virtually unchanged versus the Aussie and the Japanese yen. Now, the weakening of the US dollar and the Japanese yen suggests that financial markets traded in a risk-on fashion. However, the strengthening of the Swiss franc and the weakening of the Aussie point otherwise. Thus, in order to get a clearer picture with regards to the broader market sentiment, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, major EU and US indices were a sea of green, with the S&P 500 and Nasdaq hitting fresh record highs. That said, investors' morale softened during the Asian session today. Although South Korea's KOSPI gained 1.58%, Japan's Nikkei 225, China's Shanghai Composite, and Hong Kong's Hang Seng traded virtually unchanged. It seems that following Monday's profit-taking and portfolio rebalancing, market participants turned their attention back to the positive developments over a potential coronavirus drug. Pfizer and BioNTech have already sought emergency approval from the European regulator of their vaccine candidate, while Moderna announced that it would also ask for conditional approval. Apart from vaccine hopes, what may have also fueled market sentiment may have been the testimony of Fed Chair Powell and Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin before the Senate Banking Committee. Both officials agreed to provide more help for small businesses as the economic relief following the distribution of a vaccine may not arrive in time to keep them from failing. Although Democrats said that Mnuchin's decision to shut Fed's emergency lending programs seemed to contradict his call for help, Powell agreed that at this point businesses may need outright grants from the government instead of piling on more debt. He also agreed that a separate Treasury fund could be used by the incoming administration of President-elect Joe Biden to re-establish the Fed lending programs if they are needed. On top of that, Mnuchin held talks with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi over a potential fiscal aid, while a bipartisan group of senators and House members proposed $908 billion US dollars worth of coronavirus relief package in a bid to pass a bill sometime this month. US Senate leader Mitch McConnell also raised the importance of including a fresh wave of coronavirus stimulus in a must-pass spending bill aimed at avoiding a government shutdown in the midst of the pandemic. All these are in line with our view. Remember that yesterday, despite Monday's setback in equities, we remained positive over the broader market sentiment. We based our view on the positive developments surrounding a potential coronavirus vaccine, while headlines pointing to more fiscal and monetary policy support add more credence. We stick to our guns that equities and other risk-linked assets are likely to continue marching north, while safe havens, the likes of the US dollar and the Japanese yen, could stay under selling interest. As for today's events in the US, besides the second round of Powell's and Mnuchin's testimony, this time before the House Financial Services Committee, we also have the ADP employment report for November. The private sector is forecast to have gained 400,000 jobs after adding 365,000 in October. This could raise speculation that the NFP print due out on Friday may also exceed October's number, which was at 638,000. That said, as we noted several times in the past, the ANDP print is far from a reliable predictor of where the NFPs may come in. Even last month, when the ADP slowed to around half, to 365,000 from 749,000, NFPs stayed close to their September figure. They came in at 638,000 compared to September's 672,000. The Energy Information Administration weekly report on crude oil inventories is due to be released as well, with the forecast pointing to a 2,358 million barrels decline after a 0.754 million slide the week before. That said, bearing in mind that the American Petroleum Institute reported a 4.146 million barrels increase, we would consider the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration report as tilted to the upside. In any case, this week, oil traders are likely to keep their gaze locked on the outcome of the OPEC Plus meeting, where members will decide whether to increase production or extend the existing curbs. As for the speakers, apart from Powell and Mnuchin, we have four more on the agenda. Those are Fed Board Governor Randall Quartz, New York Fed President John Williams, ECB Chief Economist Philip Lane, and Bank of England Monetary Policy Committee member Jonathan Haskell. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT. Just fair and direct.